Well, good morning, OCC. It's a pleasure to be here. Are y'all ready to worship? All right, let's stand to our feet, put our hands together and clap, and we're going to start with...
Check.
1, 2.
Get my guitar all set up here. It's a great... Is it getting warmer out there now? It's going to get warm in here, folks.
Let there be joy, let there be peace,
let there be power, let there be praise,
let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost.
Thanks, Tom.
It was for freedom we were set free, let every mountain be cast to the sea, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. Let there be joy, let there be peace, let there be power, let there be praise, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. It was for freedom we were set free, let every mountain be cast to the sea, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. We will proclaim it to the nations, the righteousness of God in which we stand. We will proclaim it to the heavens. They shall hear, every eye shall see, every heart will understand. Let there be joy, let there be joy, let there be peace, let there be power, let there be praise, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. It was for freedom we were set free, let every mountain be cast to the sea, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. We will declare it to the heavens, the righteousness of God in which we stand. Proclaim it to the nations. Every eye shall see, every ear shall hear, every heart will understand. Let there be joy, let there be peace, let there be power, let there be praise, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. It was for freedom we were set free, let every mountain be cast to the sea, let there be joy, joy in the Holy Ghost.
Let there be
joy, joy in the Holy Ghost.
Can we get the lyrics on the screen?
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would be set free. the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy,
worthy, worthy.
This is the chaos back into order. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? Who brings the glory? The King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King of
power. Your name is healing.
just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Jesus this morning, Lord.
as we've just sung over evil, over depression, over anxieties that we all have. We just speak the name of Jesus, Father. Your name is power. Not just words, your name is power, Father. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
You're rich in love and your love through anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. Goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Worship your holy name. Sing thy Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name.
Strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. We worship your holy name. We worship your holy name. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise your name, Father. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Father. Give him praise this morning, church. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We worship his holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. Praise God.
Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Elaine, Tom, Scott, and Andrew for leading us. You may be seated, and we'll invite our boys and girls to head on out to OCC Kids. If you're visiting with us this morning, you're welcome. It's good to have you with us. I encourage you to take one of the welcome cards in the chair rack in front of you, fill that in, and take it out to the Welcome Center. And Janice is on the Welcome Center this morning, so she'll give you a bag with some goodies in it. It's one of the things we're in the midst of. We're looking and searching for and asking God to give us a worship leader. And one of the privileges we get is we get a number of different groups that have come in. So Scott's been here, and then he brought Tom and Elaine with him with this morning as we search for that. And next week, Yawen and his team is going to be here. And then the week after that, Beck and Jeff are going to be leading us in worship. So that's a privilege. That's a joy that we have. But please be praying that the right person would come along. We've got probably about 20 people who have applied, but all of them are in Nigeria. And so we're still seeking on what the Lord has for us on that. Tonight, 6:30 to 7:30, we're meeting here in person to pray together. And so we're going to be in Theater 4, one of the classrooms back there. And so let me encourage you to join us for that time. Next Sunday, the 11th, plan on staying after the morning service. We're going to have a barbecue, and there's a sign-up list at the Welcome Center. So make sure you sign up, simply so we know how many are coming, so we can provide for that and plan on ideally bring a salad. OCC is providing everything else, and so that would be great. This Thursday, yes. Women are having an information session on a trip to Israel. Men met last week. Women are meeting this week for a couple of possible trips that are coming up. Well, the women's trip is a definite yes. Men's trip is we're still working on some dates on that. And men, if you're interested and you weren't able to be at the meeting last Tuesday, talk to Neil. Neil's down. Neil, wave your hand. So talk to Neil. This month of June, our one is with Green Haven's Women's Shelter, and they've asked us for body wash. And so let's collect a whole ton of body wash and just really bless that organization and the ministry to women who've had to leave some difficult circumstances. And so let's just really, really bless them. So as you're out shopping over the next month, bring in either one or a whole case of body wash. Yeah, we got room for everybody. And so plan on doing it. Youth are meeting tonight, and so that's the other thing that's happening to today. Let's come before our Lord and pray. There's lots to pray about, and let's just come and we've sung, Lord, I speak Jesus, and so Lord, we just speak the name of Jesus this morning. We invite your Spirit to work in our hearts and our lives. We invite you to change things. We invite you to convict us, to challenge us. We invite you to encourage us. Father, we pray that you would be doing that for us here in OCC, for your church in this city, across this country, around the globe. Remind us that our foundation is Jesus. Our hope, our foundation, this kingdom that we stand on is rooted and grounded in you. Remind us of that, Lord, because there's so much shaking going on in our world, so much shaking in our hearts and lives, and we need you to speak. And so, Father, as we pray this morning, we've come with a whole multitude of things, and there's everything from physical needs, and we don't minimize those in any way. And Lord, I think particularly of Aaron as he goes for surgery tomorrow, and of Dwayne who had a burst blood vessel. Lord, we just lift them up before you this morning, and just bring healing and bring a sense of your presence with Aaron. Father, for others who are facing some severe health needs, Lord, just speak your word of comfort, your word of peace into it. Lord, we pray for Sean, who's speaking down in Inniswood, and they've asked him to continue there until the end of December. And so, Lord, I pray for our brother, and just enable him to minister your grace and your power into that congregation. Father, we pray for not just ourselves, but Lord, we pray for the much bigger world. We pray for the places where there's your people are being persecuted, countries and nations where there's conflict, places that need your healing because of the trauma that they've experienced. Father, I think of China, which is trying to block out the memory of Tiananmen Square, which took place on this date several years ago. And they're trying to eliminate that, trying to rewrite history. And Father, I pray for our brothers and sisters in that land. Give them strength and courage to speak. Lord, we hear stories all the time of pastors being arrested, of churches being shut down, of believers being thrown in prison. Father, I pray that you would give them your strength, your courage, your wisdom as they speak and live out of the hope that you offer them, that you work in them. In the midst of and in spite of all of the dire situations, Lord, we know that your kingdom is expanding in the hearts and the lives of men and women around the world. And so, Lord, we pray. We pray as you taught your disciples to pray, a prayer that invites your kingdom to grow and to expand. And so let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, may your holy name be honored. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need. Forgive us the wrongs we have done, as we forgive the wrongs that others have done to us. Do not bring us to hard testing, but keep us safe from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's watch this short video.
I follow a Jesus-looking God.
Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life.
Jesus changed my life.
The Bible is God's word.
How do you reconcile science with the Bible?
The Holy Spirit guides my decisions every day.
Jesus is the perfect example of
life. The Bible has come alive to me in ways I never could
have imagined. I follow a Jesus-looking God.
Following God requires us to walk a new path.
You need to find what works for you.
I wish I could believe.
Religions aren't that different from each other. They're all about love.
Jesus,
all
you need is that.
Jesus gave us all a beautiful example to live by.
Jesus is the way of truth.
Coexist.
Jesus gave us all.
I want all my family and friends to know
that. I can't imagine
why be narrow-minded if you can embrace it all.
Jesus
is the hope of the world.
The truth is found within.
You need to find what works for you.
You need to find what works for you.
The truth is found within.
The Bible is found within.
I'm glad
to
know that truth is found within.
We're in this series right now where we're asking some questions about truth. And as that video showed, we've got all sorts of voices bombarding us. Everyone's got their opinions, and we're living in this sea of opinions that just keep coming at us. And a lot of those opinions are hostile towards one another. And so the question is, how do you know what's true in a world like this? And truth is becoming unraveled, and a lot of things that we thought were stable and we are assumed to be stable are disintegrating. They're becoming unraveled. They're falling apart. And so we're looking at how do we as followers of Jesus live God's truth in the midst of this unraveling? And we've reminded ourselves why we believe God really is love, that God is personal. We believe that God is tri-personal. He's Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God is in a real sense a we, because God is love, and love is always interpersonal. You can't have a force that's loving. You know, magnetic force or gravity is not loving. Higher powers don't love. No, love is a personal thing, and God wants a personal relationship with all of us. So I encourage you to make it a habit every day, throughout the day, to take time to talk with God, to make him your dialogue partner, block out the other stuff, and just start talking to God. Start by saying, Lord, thank you for this present moment that you are here. And just see where that conversation goes. But as that conversation goes, make sure you take time to listen. You know, we're great at talking to God. We're not quite as good at listening to what God says, but that's so important. I want to look this morning at a major objection to belief in a personal God. And it has to do with what's traditionally called the problem of evil and suffering, or the problem of suffering of evil and evil, whichever way you want to put it. The problem of evil is that if God is personal, then why does he allow so much stuff, garbage, fill in whatever word you want to use? Why does he allow all that stuff in our world? And some of it is really painful. And to be honest, a lot of the times Christians give some very unsatisfactory, some very unbiblical, some ungodly answers to hard questions like that. You know, Christians seem to always jump in with everything happens for a reason. And yes, that's true. You know, if I were to step off this platform, I would go to the floor because the law of gravity is at work. It happens for a reason. Magnetic forces come together. Everything happens for a reason. But that doesn't mean that everything is planned or everything is intentional. You know, as somebody once said, everything happens for a reason, and sometimes the reason is you're stupid and you make bad choices. You know, we laugh at such statements, but it's true. We make bad choices. We have that opportunity to make bad choices. But it's sad when Christians say things like everything happens for a reason in the midst of evil and suffering. Family longs for a child, and she finally gets pregnant, and the baby's born, stillborn. Or a person graduates from university, top of their class, has a bright future ahead of them, and they're in a car or a bicycle accident, and they're either killed or severely injured. And some things are hard to understand, because God's ways are not our ways, and his ways are higher than our ways, and then that's true. But sometimes, as Christians, we start to try to explain this. And sometimes good people will say, we don't understand, but we've got to believe that God's still in control of this. God is sovereign when things are going well, and he's sovereign in the tragedies. God's still on the throne. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. We have to say, blessed be the name of the Lord, whether he's giving or whether he's taking. And there's an element of that that's definitely true. But then we start to twist things a little bit, because we feel we have to give a deeper answer. And will God sends tragedies on our way to teach us a lesson. And maybe there's a lesson to be learned in this. And people have said that. And then yet any rational parent who's lost an infant like that says, I'm never going to trust God again. I'm calling the God gift off. I'm done. Let me suggest how I might respond to someone who's had stuff like that told at them. You know, God blesses you with this child. He gets your hope way up there. And then at the last minute, he kills your child to teach you a lesson. But he doesn't tell you what the lesson is. You know, I would respond with something like, you know, I'm sorry, but that sounds like what a mob boss would do to their worst enemy. Hey, Luigi, I'm going to kill your kid to teach you a lesson, but I'm not going to tell you what the lesson is. Or the abusive parent who slaps their kid and says, hey, guess why I did that? I'm not going to tell you. That doesn't sound like the God that I know. That sounds something much more like what the evil one, the devil, would say than what God would say. You see, the foundation, the basis for all of our thinking about God has to be rooted and grounded in Jesus, because Jesus reveals a God of perfect love, and perfect love doesn't go around killing kids to teach parents a lesson. Perfect love does the opposite. It's always on the side of life. And God's heart is breaking for people who've lost a child. God's not in the killing business. God's in the healing business. And my prayer, what I'd say to a family that's lost a loved one, lost a child, whether it's stillborn or as a young adult, is that you'd come to understand a picture of God that's worthy of loving, that's worthy of worship, and to invite God in on your pain, because he's already there. He's on the inside of your pain. He cries with you, and he wants to bear this with you. You are not alone. And my hope, my prayer, is that you can rekindle that relationship and find healing in the midst of that terrible tragedy that's happened. You know, it's almost impossible to go through this world and without experiencing some level of pain. You know, there's all sorts of personal stuff, but then you get bombarded by stuff that happens in the world around us. There's so much pain in the world. There's so much ugliness, and you know, the fighting and the bickering. And if we're wise, we'll learn to turn off our internet feed or turn off the TV. I'm not sure we're designed to carry all of the bad news. It doesn't mean we hide ourselves and put our head in the sand. But we need to be careful. We can't be overwhelmed with that. And so with all the pain in the world, a lot of people are asking the question, how do you believe in a personal God who creates this world, who is governing this world, who cares about each one of us when there's so much pain, when there's so much suffering going on all over the globe? And a lot of people are finding that it's just impossible. And what intensifies that problem significantly is that many Christians, when it comes to responding to human suffering, responding to tragic events, have responses, like, God's timing is always right. I'm sorry, but God must have needed your child in heaven more than you needed him here down on earth. I've heard people say that at funerals, and that is simply wrong. When it comes to tragedy, I think many of us as Christians, we fall back more on Hallmark cards than on what God's word says. And Hallmark cards assume that every event, including tragic events, are somehow part of God's great plan. There's a plan here at work, and whatever comes to pass, it all contributes to this great master plan. And so God's timing is the right time. And so if a child dies in the process of a child, it happened on the right time. It was supposed to happen. But think about the implications of that. For every tragedy that's ever happened, for every child that was gassed at Auschwitz, it happened just at the right time. It died at the right time. It was God's timetable. Do we really want to say that about every child that's sold into sex trafficking or kidnapped or raped or murdered? Every person who's lost a loved one, every person who's died in a senseless war, everyone died right on time according to plan. So it was supposed to happen. Sorry, no way. See, it's one thing to accept mystery, that we don't understand the ways of God. But when it comes to saying that everything here is part of God's doing, it's twisted. If it's just a higher power, it doesn't concern us. But if God is a personal God who cares intimately about each one of us, he doesn't manipulate and control things. Here's the thing. All of our cues about God are to be taken from Jesus Christ, who is the full revelation of God. That's how Hebrews 1 begins. Going through a long line of prophets, God's been addressing our ancestors in different ways for centuries. And recently, he spoke to us directly through his Son. By his Son, God created the world in the beginning, and it will all belong to the Son at the end. This Son perfectly mirrors God and is stamped with God's nature. He holds everything together by what he says, by his powerful words. Here's the thing. Jesus spent his entire life of ministry dealing with people who had afflictions, who were suffering in a whole variety of ways. And never once does Jesus suggest that a person's affliction and suffering was part of God's great plan. He never did. He say, God's ways are not your ways. You've just got to accept this. Jesus never said, I don't know why you've got leprosy, but you know, it's just part of God's plan. You know, Jesus never suggests everything. What Jesus does do is he reveals the Father's heart and the Father's plan by healing people. Jesus is on the high side of healing, of life, of flourishing. He comes that we might have abundant life. He's not on the side of oppression and affliction and pain. He's on the side of releasing people and relieving people from their pain. And sometimes Jesus gave teachings that directly contradict this idea that you can discern the hand of God behind all of life tragedies. One of the clearest examples of that is in Luke chapter 13. Listen to this passage. About that time, some people came up to Jesus and told him about the Galileans that Pilate had killed while they were at worship, mixing their blood with the blood of the sacrifices on the altar. And Jesus responded, do you think those murdered Galileans are worse sinners than all the Galileans? Not at all. Unless you turn to God, you too will die. And what about, if this is where your faith is, I want you to invite Jesus to be very physically, to be very present in that ache. Just invite Jesus into that ache, into that pain. And allow the Holy Spirit to do what is right. To communicate to that deep place in your innermost being what needs to be communicated. Not just to your thinking, and he may want to speak something there. Not just to your emotions, your feeling, he may want to speak something there. But even deeper than that, in that place where there's no words, invite Jesus in on that memory of a hit that you took. And be aware that Jesus weeps with you. His presence negates the message that you grew up with. And some of you have heard a message growing up that you deserve this. Yet your worth is such that you deserve that abuse or that neglect. But when Jesus enters that experience with you and is sharing it with you because you are in Christ, he's saying, no, that is a lie. And he reverses the message. He says, that's not what you are worth. Your worth comes from my love for you. And you are worth me entering into this. You are worth me bringing healing into this. Let Jesus be there with you, knowing that you're not alone, that the one who loves you the most and knows you the best is on the inside. And that itself brings healing. Holy Spirit, do your work in each person's life here this morning. God, may your love and your grace, your mercy, your freedom, your life, your joy, your beauty transform you. May the beauty of God transform you into his image by means of his love, his grace. Holy Spirit, we thank you for being here, for being with us. Thank you that you are a God who is altogether good, altogether lovely, altogether pure, altogether loving, in whom there's no shadow of turning of evil. And thank you that even when we choose to go wrong ways, even when we choose to go our own way, even when there's stuff that's happening through these cosmic agents that distort and twist your creation, we can trust in your love, in your grace, and we can open our hearts and our lives to receive the healing that you want to do. Know that in the end, your love is going to win. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite team to come back and lead us as we worship our God. And as they lead us, if you're sensing you need to have someone pray for you, either during the song or at the very end, there'll be some people at the front who can pray with you.
Stand to join us.
The greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And whoa, happy day, happy day. You know it's done. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. When I stand in that place, face to face, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, oh, oh. Forever I am changed. Oh. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way. What a glorious name, Jesus, and whoa, happy day,
happy day, happy day,
happy
day, happy day,
whoa, happy day, happy day, you wash my sin away. I'll never be the same. Oh, oh, oh. Oh. Forever I am changed. Oh. I'll never be the same.
You can close it. You can close it.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a great day. God bless you all.